So there you are.
Okay. All right. So our topic is, do ghosts really exist? And then, you know, I had a debate with Phil Smith at Portland State University, and he's a Christian philosopher at George Fox University. And from memory, I'm not sure. I think he said, well, of course, I don't believe in ghosts, like haunted houses and stuff like that. But I'm not sure about Pastor Nathan and some other people, so that's why it's kind of an interesting conversation. And then just in case they say, of course, I don't believe in these silly ghosts and haunted houses, and what's the biggest ghost of all? Is the Holy Ghost, you know, according to the King James Version, or called the Holy Spirit. So next slide. This is kind of a tongue-in-cheek thing. It says, you know, you plot the number of observances, the frequency of miracles. How often do they happen over time through history? You know, there's a constant rate of miracles, and all of a sudden, the camera's invented, and poof, there's no more miracle recordings, and then it's shot again. Wow, there's a lot of recordings again. What happened? Oh, well, Photoshop was invented. So, anyway, it's a lame attempt at a joke. Next slide. Kind of another joke, too, is how many charismatic evangelical Christians does it take to screw in a light bulb? Two, one to change the bulb and one to cast out the spirit of darkness. Okay, so one person found that one. So, you know, the idea, though, that's going to be throughout this whole thing that relates to that joke is that there's a way to see everything in the world as materially, and that's it. I mean, there's just matter, there's, you know, matter and energy, but there's just natural things. And then some people see a supernatural thing behind that. So, you know, if something bad happens, it must be the spirits or demons or God or something behind this. Or could it just, you know, maybe it's just bad. Maybe a bad thing just happened because that's nature. So anyway, those are two different mentalities we have. I do not have any superstitious or supernatural, and I would call it superstitious, but I don't have any supernatural beliefs whatsoever. So I think everything's about nature. So for me, a burnt-out bulb is just a burnt-out bulb, you know. And of course, no Christian believes it's a spirit of darkness, but that's just kind of an overstatement joke. Next slide. Okay, yeah, so let's go back to that one again, the previous one. So this is just something I saw on the internet. You know, like, what are people saying about ghosts? Well, here's one that said, oh, look at this guy. His friend took a picture of him, and there's this ghost in there, and the guy who took the picture freaked out and had a heart attack, you know. Well, is this true? These are the kind of stories you hear all the time. Next page. And, you know, maybe you say, obviously, that's not true. That's kind of corny. So I just wanted to, let's look at some counterpoints of, when you think of God as a Holy Spirit or a Holy Ghost, what's going on there? What are some examples? And so I showed some of the prime examples, probably from the Bible, I think what Pastor Nathan might agree with. And one is the baptism of Jesus, where it said the Holy Spirit came and descended upon Jesus in the form of a dove. So here we have the Holy Spirit, or ghost, or whatever, and it's manifesting as a dove. Then in Acts, it appeared as tongues of fire on top of people's heads. And then the story of Moses, it said during the day, Moses led the Hebrews by a pillar of fire and at night by a cloud. So these are different manifestations of the Holy Spirit, it's claimed. Next. So here's the general idea that Catholics and Protestants, I think, agree. They have this theological hypothesis that the body consists of a body. The body consists of the natural body and also a supernatural soul, and at death they separate. And like there in 2 Corinthians 5:8, Paul says to be absent from the body to be present with the Lord. So that means his soul or spirit is with God. But philosophical naturalism, which I'm representing, says there's no supernatural soul. The mind emerges from the brain. That's very important. And, you know, so obviously as the mind goes, the brain goes. So in other words, as the brain dies, the mind dies. As the brain develops, the mind gets more developed and complex. Next line. So here's some of my overview points. Number one, about the soul and the spirit. Number one is a lack of definition of what a soul or a spirit is in theological textbooks. Some of them say they're synonyms, they're the same thing, just different words, and some of them say they're two different things. So there's a lot of controversy over even what the Christians mean by the word. The second one is that we can observe from nature the emergence of the mind when we look across different animal species. They have different levels of brains, and they have different levels of thinking based on that. You know, we get all the different mammals, like whales and dolphins, and chimps and look at their behaviors. The next one is look at the observance of the emergence of the mind or in the human life cycle. You know, when you're first conceived and you're in the womb, there's just one cell there. There's no brain, there's no neurons, there's no activity whatsoever. There's obviously no mind. And as the neurons develop and all that, then your mind develops. And then if you get in the old age and get Alzheimer's or something, your mind starts to deteriorate because your brain's deteriorating. So that's all pretty obvious. There's an interesting, the next one is split brain data. There's an interesting case where sometimes your brain has a left hemisphere and a right hemisphere, and they communicate through this communication channel between the two, and sometimes they snip that in a medical operation for people who have seizures. And so what happens is now the left brain and right brain are kind of independent. And there's this funny story where this one doctor asked, you know, both left and right brain, like, you know, each one separately, do you know where you're at? I mean, are you in Oregon, for example, or are you asleep, and are you a male or female, and all this? And there were consistent answers, and then one question was, do you believe in God? Yes, no, or not sure. And the brain answered differently. One said, yes, I do, and the other one said, no, I don't. And so the doctor said, well, what's going to happen to this guy? Is he going to go to heaven or hell by not believing or not? So it basically shows that there is no such thing as a soul, really, that's overriding everything. I mean, what we are is really just a composite of our brain's neural activities. And so, anyways, it's kind of interesting that the left and right brain are both kind of independent in some ways. And it's basically like two consciousnesses. Some people say, can you divide conscious in half? Well, yeah, there's two different consciousnesses there, in a way. We can talk more about that in the question and answer time if you want. Biblical evidence against the resurrection. The next page. I'm saying here's some reasons for not believing the Bible stories about resurrection. And that's the only reason as a Christian you believe in resurrection is because of the Bible stories. In Matthew 27, you know, it talks about when Jesus died on the cross, his bodies came to life and they walked around, these were prophets of old. And he's like, well, what happened to these guys? They go back in their tombs at night, or they live long lives and die again, or what? It doesn't say. And it just, you know, from my experience in church, they never talk about this passage because it's kind of maybe something to be ashamed of or embarrassed about, because how do you explain what's going on there? It doesn't really make any sense. And it's kind of hard to say, well, maybe that was a later edition or something, because it seems to be in the earliest editions of Matthew where it's reported. It's only reported in Matthew also as a gospel. Another one is in Acts. Jesus, you know, ascends into heaven. He just physically goes up into heaven past the clouds. Well, that's where they thought heaven was, located up there. And now with the space program, we know heaven's not physically located up there. No Christian alive would probably say heaven is located up in the sky. But those guys thought heaven was literally up there, so when they made the story up, wow, you know. Of course, he went according to their cosmology. So I think they got caught red-handed telling a story on that one. And then, you know, furthermore, they say Jesus is going to return from heaven the same way. So that's why you're going to see him come in the clouds, because that's where heaven is up there. Another passage is Mark 16. It says, you know, for the believers, if they drink poison, it won't kill them at all. Well, obviously, poison does kill the believers. Was there an expiration on that promise? Like only for the first 50 years or something? And in that one, it is easy to say, well, that was a later edition because the earlier manuscripts don't have it. But now your question is, well, why is this in the Bible if it's not part of the original? Well, because if you took it out, it'd probably be a big commotion there. Why are these passages missing from the Bible? So, you know, that's just one of the problems there. So why was the soul invented?
That's your man.
So I got 1 minute?
Yep.
Okay, so why was the soul invented? My theory, which is very popular theory probably among atheists, is that, you know, a lot of people are afraid of death and they don't want to face their death. It's hard to come, you know, face it, so it's just a way of denial. There's actual thing called terror management theory about why people invent things to avoid death or thinking about it. So my advice is just the ultimate solution is to accept it, accept your place in nature, and learn how to deal with it, and that's a long topic in itself, but that's my summary for this thing.
Okay. All right, you ready, Nathan?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay, it'll ring when you got a minute left.
Oh my.
But I think it's not gonna ring quite so.
Okay, well, happy Halloween. This Friday's Halloween. That's why Bernie's decided on this topic and I agreed to it. I'm gonna try and be more precise with my language than Bernie has been. Bernie's thrown a lot of language out there loosely, but I've known this in my discussions with him before. So, do ghosts exist? I would answer that question on the face of it, yes, but I'm gonna define terms for you, right? Because what you might think is a ghost may not be what I'm talking about. And what is more important than what you and I are thinking about that, since Bernie has a problem with the Christian scriptures, is what do the Christian scriptures, the Bible, how does the Christian Bible use that term? So Christians believe in the immaterial. That's no secret. We believe in the immaterial. We believe that the human brain projects into the immaterial mind. So we believe that we have a material brain and a material mind. Now, Bernie plays fast and loose with that, and he says, I only believe in the material, but then he just showed you a slide where he talks about the human mind. Make no mistake about it, anyone who says anything about the mind is talking about something that is immaterial. Is it connected to the material? Yes, but it is in itself immaterial. Have you thought much about the distinction between brain and mind, or are you just gonna play fast and loose with them as loose synonyms? So the Christian scriptures also talks about the soul, that immaterial core of the human being. Christians also believe in immaterial personhood or being. So we do believe that God is a spirit, and we teach our children in the catechism to answer the question, what is God? God is a spirit who does not have a body like human beings. And so we believe in the Holy Spirit, one of the persons of the Godhead, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who is not a ghost by your definition or mine, but is truly a immaterial spiritual being with personhood. So Christians also believe in otherworldly beings taking on human form. We believe in angels that are not human beings, but when they, as the messengers of God, come to deliver the very words of God to humanity so that they can be received by human beings, they take on human form. We also believe that angels are good and some evil. Those that are fallen angels are evil angels, and we call them demons. Christians also believe in human beings comprised of material and immaterial faculties, body and soul. So that's the Christian worldview on the faculties of the human person in a nutshell. The Apostle Paul's teaching, Bernie has already given to you accurately. It's really part of the gospel, the good news, that upon death, those of us who belong to Jesus, who are united to Christ Jesus by faith in him alone, that our souls upon death immediately pass into the heavenly presence of God while our bodies lay in their graves decaying. But on the great and final day of judgment, our bodies are resurrected from their graves and are reunited to our souls in heaven, and then we are forever in the presence of God. And so Bernie's already given to you that gospel today and taking issue with it. So what about a ghost? Well, a ghost by English language definition is an apparition of a dead person that is believed to appear or become manifest to the living, typically in a nebulous image. That's what a ghost is. So a ghost is not material in any way, or for that matter, it is not even an immaterial being present in our world or dimension, but it is a vision of one that has passed into another world or dimension. It is a vision projected to us in this world. That's the English language definition of a ghost. A ghost is a projected image or vision of a being that has passed through death from this world to another that is projected back into this world. So there's one text in the Bible that is problematic on this issue as to whether or not you would believe as a Christian, a Bible-believing Christian, whether or not you would believe that ghosts exist. And that's 1 Samuel 28. Are you familiar with that? The king of Israel, Saul, the first king of Israel, is bereft of the Holy Spirit. He is doing his own will and not God's will. He's made a mess of his kingdom and a mess of his life. The Philistines have his army cornered, and he is at the point of death. And in a point of desperation, he goes in the dark, disguised, to the house of a medium. And he asks that medium to conjure up the spirit of Samuel the prophet. And the medium says to him, "Don't you know that the king of Israel has prohibited this?" That's a little irony in the text. And then the text says Saul had not eaten for a whole day and night. And he said, "I assure you it's okay." And then she discovers that it's actually the king she's talking to. And she says, "Don't you know there's a death penalty for me helping you?" But he assures her it's going to be okay. And then Samuel, who has not eaten for a day or a night, sees this figure of a man that's robed and cannot see his face begin to talk to him. And the question is, what is he seeing? He believes that he has seen the ghost of Samuel projected from the world into which Samuel has left by death, projected back to him. The medium is freaking out because most likely she is a sham and she's never had something like this happen before. And so then this person robed with his face covered says to Saul everything that Saul already knows. You're going to lose the battle. You and your sons are going to die tomorrow morning in the battle. It's God's done with you. You forsook him. He's not on your side anymore. And so then the question is, did Samuel really see a ghost? Saul, did King Saul really see a ghost? He thinks he has. He's sleep deprived and he hasn't had any food. And I don't know what you're like in that kind of a condition, but I've seen all sorts of things. And maybe you've taken some substances that have helped you see some other things too. I don't know. That's your personal business. Okay, so I won't hold it against you. Just all that to say, the Bible is quite candid, not steering away from uncomfortable stories, but not everything you read in the Bible is God saying, this is what's going on. Don't you know you should believe in ghosts because King Saul saw a ghost when he was sleep and food deprived and thought that what he was seeing. So just my estimation of that text is that Saul saw and heard either the devil, who is a real person as presented in the Bible, or a demon, or he saw a live human being playing a really good trick on the medium and Saul. So he didn't see a projection from the world beyond. Also, another thing to note is that the term ghost in this text is a Hebrew word that is only sometimes translated ghost, but by ghost, the Hebrew doesn't have this projection definition in it. I heard that, Charlie. It has to do with a real being that is able to go from one world to another, from one dimension to another, hence the devil, a demon, an angel. So most often in the Bible, in the Hebrew Bible, this word that's translated ghost often in 1 Samuel 28 is often, most often translated God or angel, a being that goes from one world and dimension to another for a particular purpose. Just to let you know, a ghost is a projection, a vision of a being that has passed out of this world and dimension into another world and dimension projected back to us. So it really does help for us to speak the same language with the same definitions assigned to them before we take big grand pot shots at an entire corpus of religious material that spans 1,500 years from multiple authors from multiple cultures.
Okay, our second part of this program is where Bernie and Nathan ask questions of each other. And so, is it you get to ask him first? Is that?
I think he should go, he should ask me first because I presented first.
Okay.
And so he didn't ask me about my presentation.
So, okay, so Bernie.
So I'm going to give each of you, each have 5 minutes to ask questions of the other, and your alarm will ring off at 4 minutes.
All right, so Bernie, putting aside your poor jokes, which I would have, if it was earlier in the day, I would have laughed at, because I agree with you on all of those things, you know. It's true. I don't know how many atheists it takes to screw in a light bulb. But I'll tell you this. What I heard you say tonight is that you are purely secularist, and you only believe in the material. But then you have on your slide the general idea. You have the Catholic Protestant theological hypothesis pitted against the philosophical naturalism hypothesis. And in that latter hypothesis, you talk about the brain, the material brain, being projected into the immaterial mind. If you are purely secularist and only believe in material, can you please explain to me how you have any kind of a psychology or a taxonomy that allows you to talk as research has talked for the last 85 years about the relationship of the brain to the mind?
Okay, can I first address some of your terms? For example, I mean, you basically said I'm a secularist and a materialist, so can I address that first?
Right, only because you told us that tonight. I'm using your very words.
No, I never said I'm a secularist. And
well, I'll say, I was just being polite. Are you an atheist?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, so as an atheist, you told us tonight you only believe in the material.
Well, and that's a little tricky too. I mean, material, I mean, also energy, for example, equals mc squared. So energy is not material, so that's kind of confusing there.
Only to you it's confusing.
No.
Because I believe in the immaterial. You said you don't believe in the material.
Well, is energy immaterial?
Well, that's for you to answer because you said you only believe in the material. I'm fine with EMC squared.
Yeah, okay, and I think I tried to correct myself, and basically I say I only believe in the natural. So I'm just saying I believe in the natural, not the supernatural.
Well, then define what you mean by natural.
Natural is basically, it's kind of, okay, by natural I mean nature. So usually supernatural is something above nature. So for example, if I had grape juice here and turned it into wine, that'd be a supernatural thing.
Why? Because both of them are natural. Grape juice and wine are both natural.
Yes, but it's not natural for grape juice to turn into wine.
Given enough time, it always does.
I know, but by waving
more vinegar.
But if you do an incantation or wave your hand over it, everybody knows that's a magic trick and that's not going to happen. But if you have supernatural powers, you could make it happen. So you believe Jesus actually did it because he has supernatural powers.
But now you're talking about Jesus, and I don't want to talk about Jesus.
Okay, but I'm just saying.
I want you to talk about natural.
Yeah, so I'm just saying it's an example of supernatural. We
right.
Make things that don't normally happen.
I know you have trouble with Jesus. What my concern is, I'm not so sure that you know what you mean when you say you're a materialist.
Well,
we've been at this point before in these forums.
I don't primarily ever call myself a materialist. I kind of slipped out and I think I corrected myself right away. I don't like that word. I can be called a materialist, but I don't like that word because I don't think it's very descriptive. That's why I said philosophical naturalist, and it actually says philosophical naturalist.
Well, the problem with naturalist is that that's been defined for a good long time as, and the basic definition of naturalism is an ideology of despair.
No.
That's what naturalism is. Naturalism defined not only in literature, but in philosophy is that the world is controlled by fate and there's nothing. Jack London understood naturalism as you don't. And that is that the world is controlled by fate and so it is a despairing sphere in which we live because we have no control. even over our personal lives. Sooner or later, the snow or the wolves are going to kill us. That is naturalism. That's how it's defined. If you want to redefine it, I'm all ears.
No, I think that's really unfair to say naturalism is despair. I could say the same thing about Christianity is despair and nihilism too. I could make that argument. That's not a definition of naturalism at all.
Well, I didn't make up the definition. See, we can, I think that you just, as your friend, I'm just asking you to be more clear on the terms that you use so we can have a dialogue.
Right. So basically what I said is that I believe that the mind and consciousness emerges from the brain. Okay, and of course the mind is not physical. Of course the mind is not something you can touch. But it emerges from the brain. It comes from the brain. This is I give you an example I came up with. I've never heard anybody else say this, but it's like the immune system, for example. The immune system is not something you can touch or feel or whatever, but it's something that the body does to heal itself.
Okay, now, Bernie, it's your turn to spend 5 minutes asking Nathan questions.
Well, I just said something, too. We can give him a few seconds to follow up if he wants to.
No, I'm fine. I think I've heard you, and I've heard you really backpedal from saying tonight that you're a materialist, but now you really aren't because you do believe in quite a bit that's immaterial. You believe in the mind. Now you've mentioned the conscience, and now you've mentioned the immune system. You mentioned a few minutes ago EMC squared, so I'm fine. I'm fine that you understand that there are immaterial aspects to reality, to nature, because that's the world I live in, and that's my argument, is that if you can conceive or believe in the immaterial, then we can talk about all of these things that you have dissed in your 15 minutes.
Okay, and just briefly, I do believe in the immaterial, no problem whatsoever. It's just the supernatural I do not believe in. Okay, so my question to you is, so let's say, for example, somebody said there's a haunted house over there. Do you think that could be haunted by real ghosts? Now, I think you said that you don't believe that there's ghosts in the sense that there's people that were alive and they died and those are the ghosts, but so I think from that you would say no, but what about maybe, could they be demons pretending to be that kind of a situation?
Well, I think my presentation was fairly clear. From my, did you listen to my presentation? Mm-hmm. What do you think I believe then?
Well, I'd just like to ask you now.
Okay, so a ghost is a projected, it's an apparition. An apparition is a projected image from one dimension, from one world to another, okay? I don't know of any ghosts that are listed in the Bible. 1 Samuel talks about this figure appearing before King Saul. He believes that it is the ghost of Samuel. Just because King Saul believes it's a ghost doesn't mean that the scripture is saying this is a ghost, or that I need to believe that this is a ghost.
Okay, let me ask a little clarifying question. Suppose somebody came to you and said, Pastor, I believe my house is possessed. Could you please come and say a blessing or something and get rid of the ghost there? Would you do that?
Oh, I've done that on a number of occasions because I believe, as I said in my presentation, with Christendom, mm-hmm. I believe in demons and angels. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in personal beings that are material and immaterial. And I believe in immaterial personal beings that appear as personal beings.
And if somebody came to you and said, I believe I'm possessed by an evil spirit, would you please pray for me and cast it out?
I'll tell you this. The older I get, Bernie, the less I am willing to disbelieve what people tell me. And for the main reason, I've got a selfish reason for that. It takes too much work for me to disbelieve everyone. As a minister, people tell me the screwiest things. And I am tired of disbelieving them. A good friend of mine, a medical doctor, corrected me. He and I, for years, ran together. And I told him this screwy story that my neighbor told me. And I told my neighbor, you are full of hooey. Well, that's what I'm telling you, I told her. I told her, in other terms, I don't believe anything you're saying about that story. And my doctor friends told me, you know, Nathan, I learned a long time ago, because as a doctor, people come into my office and say all sorts of things. And now I say to them, thank you for sharing with me your story. That's very interesting.
Okay, but my question was, if somebody came to you and said, Pastor, I think I'm possessed by an evil spirit, would you please cast it out of me? Would you try to cast it out of them? Would you pray?
Well, Charlie knows that last night I preached on this, and I don't believe that I am called or endowed with the power to exorcise, but I do know those who are. Mm-hmm. And yes, I do believe that demons possess human beings at times. I don't believe that this is something that is widespread. And I do believe that there are those who have the power and the calling to exercise.
Okay, one final question. What do you think about that split brain experiment where they asked a person with a split brain?
Well, I think the way you presented it is really bad science. You presented it anecdotally, just like your jokes. And so I haven't seen a medical journal on that. Mm-hmm. I don't have anything, you know, at my level of education, I'm not going to disbelieve you, as I said, mm-hmm. but I'm also not going to just sit here and say anything more than thank you, Bernie. That's an interesting story.
Okay, just for people who want to see it afterwards, I do have in the notes of it a YouTube video of it where people, if they want to hear
I go to YouTube late at night when my brain is fried and I want to be entertained. Mm-hmm. How many of you do that? Yeah, that's what I do with YouTube. I don't go to YouTube to find medical journal findings.
It was a medical doctor at a debate, though, so it was a clip from it. It was a clip from a professional.
Yeah, that's one of the problems with our world right now. We're all going to YouTube, friends.
Okay, and he's the head of a brain and cognitive science department. So.
And he's on YouTube.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so now we come to the third part of our presentation today, where we have audience Q&A. And that's audience Q and presenter A. So you each have an opportunity to ask questions. I will call on you. You can ask a question either to be addressed to both of these individuals. You can ask a question to be directed to one of them or the other one. I would ask that you try to ask questions rather than make long speeches. Partly because we have a lot of people here and we want to give everybody an opportunity for that. And also for that same reason, I'd like to ask you to expect that you'll have one chance to ask a question until everybody has had a chance to ask a question. We'll allow a certain amount of give and take and back and forth, but do remember to not take up all the time. And remember, there's other people who would want to ask questions too. So take some time to think about your questions. And also in this time, you should remember that these are subjects that a lot of people feel very strongly about. So if you start feeling yourself getting hot under the collar, that's not a problem. But you know, you might want to take a little break. You can go smoke on the porch. You can take a bathroom break, or and then come back in. There's more coffee and pizza and cake. I hope you realize there is cake. So who wants to be brave and have the first question? Yes, right here.
All right, so this is for both Bernie and for Nathan. So in April of 2003, I was in Haiti. And in that week, 8 days that I was there, toward the end of my time, I was with a gentleman, a friend of mine. It's near the equator, so the sun goes down pretty early. So it's 7 o'clock at night, it's a Friday night. It happens to be in the part of Haiti we were in. It's a very rural area, very heavily saturated with voodoo religion as part of the culture. And so it's just after dark, and just over the wall where we were, the compound area we were staying in, was this village. And the village, the folks that were native Haitians there, was a primarily voodoo area and village, and this religious ceremony was going on. And long story short, is it goes on for about an hour, lots of singing, drumming, chanting, and fires, and I don't know what all was going on. We weren't there, but we could hear it. And my friend David and I, if he was here, he'd give you the same exact story. As soon as it ended, within 60 seconds of when it ended, we happened to be looking in that direction over the wall into this banana plantation. And from the direction the noise was coming from right to left and no further than the school across the parking lot, at a very, very slow pace, this thing went from right to left across the horizon, 200 feet away. And it was no animal. It was no biological thing that I could explain. And it just floated across the sky, right there. And I looked at my friend and I said, "Did you see that?" And he said, "Yeah, I saw that." And again, I use the same language like Nathan. That's what I'm saying to you, I said. But at the time, I was like, "Oh my goodness, what are we witnessing here?" And I can't speak to the hypothetical, you know, the ghost you're talking about living in a haunted building somewhere. But I know what I saw. And I know it was no bird. And it was at least 15 or 20 feet large. It was gigantic. And it was not, there were no wings. There was nothing I can explain. And it went right to left. And it was gone. And when it was gone, it was really gone. When it was there, it was really there. So, as much as I've told you, you can ask me questions, I can try to fill in gaps, but what do you think I saw, Bernie? Nathan, what do you think I saw?
Okay, I have some responses. One is, I know a woman who was a Christian, very evangelical Christian, is now an atheist, but she also had an experience one time. She was playing cards, and her friend, they saw this beam of light or something travel down, and they were all convinced it was a spirit of some sort. And I asked her now as an atheist, "What do you think that was?" And she's like, "I don't know." So it's like, I just don't know. These are some weird sightings, weird things. One thing I'm wondering is, yeah, I mean, it kind of sounds like a UFO. It's unidentified flying objects. It's something unidentified, really. You know, if you're out in the desert and you're really, really thirsty, and you know, you might see an oasis out there. It looks certainly looks real, but you know, it's not. So sometimes, you know, it's hard to say. But you know, and here's one more thing I would consider too. Sometimes people, I thought you might say, well, somebody needed something and they prayed for it and they got it. And it's kind of like, well, why is God, there's this Robert Ingersoll once said about this woman who was starving and then some other woman had a vision that said, God is bountiful. There's one mountain of butter and another mountain of bread, and he can supply all your needs. And sure enough, later on, she was taken care of. But it's like, what about all the other 40,000 children that are dying every day of starvation? How does this make sense? You got one little isolated thing here. What's the spirit trying to show? So it's, in the perspective of everything, it doesn't seem to make sense.
Do you know anything about the voodoo religion?
Yeah.
They were invoking. Mm-hmm. The entire point was to invoke the spirit world.
Yeah.
To bring upon themselves.
Sure.
Yeah. These things.
Right.
So, what do you think I saw, Bernie?
Well, you could have saw that whether, I don't know what it was, but the thing is, maybe you would have saw that even if there was no voodoo that night. Maybe there was some kind of phenomena there. Maybe your pattern-seeking brain, which we all do, maybe you put these patterns together. Oh, because of that, this. We do that all the time and make false correlations.
I saw it just like I'm seeing you.
No, I'm not saying you didn't see it. I'm saying maybe you're making a false correlation that it has anything whatsoever to do with the voodoo thing.
So
maybe there was Baptists down the street that cast out a demon and they did it.
So what you're saying, Bernie, is that you're not denying that John saw something, but you're thinking that he made a connection between this voodoo ceremony going on and the thing he saw that connection may not be.
Well, the bottom ultimate line is that it just seems like it's a UFO. Unidentified is the key word, you know, flying object. It's unidentified, and you know, a lot of people see UFOs all the time, but what are they? Sometimes they're totally unknown still. Sometimes they're weather balloons, sometimes they're this or that. Sometimes they're unresolved. We don't know.
Okay, Nathan, what do you have to say?
Well, thank you for sharing your story, John. That's very interesting. And I tend to agree with Bernie because I didn't hear Bernie deny your story. And I agree with him. I wasn't there. I believe that you saw something and you saw it clearly, and there was a powerful impact around what you saw. But I don't know what it is. But I won't deny your experience in that instance. And, you know, the context for anything is important, probably more important than simply my personal experience, but the entire context there. So it would be interesting to know what the Voodoo Village saw that night. It'd be interesting to see what the rest of the Christian community saw that night. And I perfectly agree with Bernie. Down the road, there could have been a group of Baptist exorcists who sent that shadow on its way. So I'm with Bernie on this one.
Okay, next question.
We can't top that.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Me?
Yes, you.
Yeah. It seems to me that the human brain is capable of a lot of things that we don't understand. And we want to, as humans, understand everything. So we leap to some kind of idea that sounds good to us when we see something that we don't understand. Now, I learned a very positive lesson back in college taking Introduction to Philosophy. Because I was a thinker, and I was, you know, wanted the answer to everything. And the teacher said, you know, there's nothing wrong with waiting to make your decision up. You don't have to make it right now. And so many things like that have come back to me that I don't decide right then what is the truth, and it comes back to me. Now, Bernie, I'm wondering, do you believe in any kind of non-material things?
Sure, the mind is non-material.
Well, it comes from the mind.
The cells
of the mind.
The mind emerges from the brain, you mean. It comes from the brain.
Huh?
The mind comes from the brain.
I don't think you can separate the mind and the brain. Okay, that's a dualism. That don't work. Okay, you won't have a mind if you don't have a brain.
No, wait. I don't think that's dualism. Everybody agrees there's a mind. The question of dualism is that a separate substance? I think dualism could be complicated.
You can't have thoughts without a brain. Okay.
I agree. Yes.
So you're not going to get one without the other. So you can't separate them. And
you're agreeing with me then, right?
Hmm?
We agree, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, I'm a material. I mean,
I'm a materialist. You said that the mind was a material thing.
No, the mind is not a material. No, immaterial. The mind is an immaterial thing.
Okay, so you do believe in things that are immaterial?
Yeah, sure. Like the mind, yes.
Oh, anything else?
Numbers.
Hmm?
Numbers. They say number three, number five. They're not in nature anywhere. Those are human things. Like I said earlier, the immune system, your blood flow. Your blood is flowing, but the circulatory system, things like that. They're not really things.
My circulatory system is a thing.
Well, there are delusions.
Definitely a thing. It's material.
Okay, sorry.
Believe me, my doctor agrees with me.
But your blood, okay. I mean, your blood is obviously material.
There's delusions.
Yeah, everything about my circulatory system is material.
Okay, sorry.
I talked to a woman one day trying to sell her a television, and her husband wanted a Mitsubishi, and she said no. And I asked her why. And she told me because I lived in Hawaii. And I thought, well, she was old enough to be there the day it was bombed. I said, is that, you got something against? No, everything in my house, including the flower pot that was made in Japan, exploded. Now, and then she stopped herself after a little bit and said, you know, I've been talking kind of crazy, haven't I? Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, I think you bring up some good points, too, about neurology. I've heard somebody say that. Neurology, this is a science that's, like, less than 100 years old. And, of course, they're making breakthroughs right and left. And I think this actually scares religious people because, you know, we can study the brain just like we can study any other body part. But the problem is the brain strikes at your identity. and it strikes at the theological views of the soul and all that stuff. I mean, the heart and circulatory system, that's no problem. The Bible doesn't say anything about that. But
it says a lot about it.
Not as far as being supernatural or whatever, but...
Let me ask you a question. How can scientists figure out, make a hypothesis of something that's real in the world, as they call it, and do the hypothesis and, you know, the stuff, and they come up with the thing they only thought about? It was there before they thought about it.
But yeah, they might call it a discovery. I mean,
you're
just talking about scientists are trying to discover reality, trying to uncover what reality is.
Yeah, but it was there.
Sure.
It was there before they had the
idea. Reality is there, and the truth is there, and we're trying to discern what that is, yeah.
Okay, let's go on. I think there's another question, ma'am, behind. Yep, right here. No, you're
well,
not there. Not here. Let's looking back. Yeah, that's right, you.
Well, I wanted to know if either one of you wanted to know what a definition of naturalism is.
Sure, go ahead.
It is the philosophical belief that everything arises from natural properties and causes, and supernatural or spiritual explanations are excluded or discounted. Is that what you meant, Bernie?
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's why I thought I said it.
Everyone else seems to be making a comment, so I'm going to make a comment.
Did you have another question you want to ask?
Well, what would Pastor Nathan say to that? Because Pastor Nathan said there was a different definition.
Well, I think if you do some more research, you'll see that naturalism is a particular philosophy that believes more than what you just read, and it believes in an impersonal fate, and that leads to despair, because there is no way that you or I, or us collectively, can do anything about these natural processes going forward.
I have a question.
Yeah.
If we're talking about something like energy or electromagnetism, there are processes to discern whether that exists that one can repeat over time. What processes do you believe exist to prove that there's a soul? Or that angels exist that can be repeated and shown, or demons, or anything that's...
Well, I would say generally, Karen, that in this world, you and I believe in hundreds upon hundreds of truths that we hold dear that cannot be substantiated in a Petri dish or in some other kind of a lab experiment. And you just have to think about everything that you hold dear and that you believe. Begin with relationships. Begin with anything that you don't think can grow in a Petri dish or that can be given a litmus test. Not everything that we hold to be real and true is material or defined by some kind of a material test performed in a laboratory. Just think about everything you believe in.
Well, I would have a comment there. You said there's hundreds of things we believe in that don't have evidence that they exist. I mean, I can't think of one thing, really.
Well, go to the laboratory and find a laboratory test that will prove to you that your wife loves you.
Okay, so I don't need to go into the laboratory to find out if something's true or real. I mean, I can...
Okay, but Karen just asked that.
There are ways to find out if you can test relationships. Mm-hmm. I mean, people say all the time, you don't love me, you don't... And what are they looking for? They're looking for signs. There are signs.
They're looking for the roses on Valentine's.
Yeah, my point was in response to Karen saying, if you can't prove it in a laboratory, tell me how you know it's true.
I didn't say laboratory.
Well, you said electromagnetic energy can be proven through tests. I'm saying that take relationships, take the value of your stocks, take all sorts of things you hold dear, and tell me how you know those to be true and real. They won't be the same way that we prove electromagnetic energy. Not everything comes from the laboratory. I'll stick by that point.
Well, they're not all tested the same way, but you said stocks. You mean like stocks you trade? Stock market?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Like, I know what they're worth at a given point in the day, but what I don't always know is how I'm tied to one. Like, am I going to sell my Tesla stock or not? Oh, I just love those cars. They have such value to me as an idea. See, there's so much more to our reality than what the stock is worth at 11 a.m. on Monday morning.
But I think she's talking about existence. We know we all agree that stocks exist.
Does your wife's love exist for you?
There's ways to measure that and look for that.
Right, and I'm saying that they are not scientific proofs. That's my only point.
Well, Karen, let's let somebody else have a crack.
You can't take a blood sample from your wife's body, take it to the lab, and the doctor comes back and says, "Oh, she doesn't love you."
Right, and that would be an inappropriate test, but I think there are appropriate tests that you can use logic and reason to see if things exist. I disagree that there's hundreds of things we all believe and that have no evidence whatsoever for. I disagree with your statement about that.
Okay, this gentleman here in the aisle.
Okay, let's get back to ghosts.
Yeah, thank you.
History is filled with hundreds, if not thousands, of stories about ghosts from cultures all around the world. It's not just limited to one part of the world or one specific time period. You can find hundreds of stories. Mm-hmm. Jesus, even in the upper room, had told his disciples, "I'm not a ghost." Okay. Given the fact that there's all these stories about ghosts throughout history, don't you think the odds would be that a few of them would be true?
Okay, well, I have a couple interesting comments there. Number one, yeah, you probably heard a whole lot about haunted houses, right? Where's one in the United States? One. Now, if there was one haunted house you could find, where is the university studying it? And, you know, I looked one time, what kind of universities, state universities, not religious seminaries or anything, what state universities actually have paranormal programs? They used to actually have some when I was kind of interested in the 60s or 70s, I guess, but I think now there might be one or two in the whole nation that study paranormal activity, and, of course, they're not coming up with anything. They're not writing any papers. They're not finding any breakthroughs. They're just doing investigations. So, yeah, look at all your stories about haunted houses. None. I mean, just think, if you could find one, just one haunted house anywhere in America, just one, come on, not even one, but there's so many stories, can't one of them be true?
Nathan, would you like to respond?
Yeah, just in short, that, you know, before we discount hundreds or thousands of stories throughout different cultures and religions, think about your personal story or your personal testimony to anything, and you believe that to be true. And the main reason you believe that to be true, it's because it's you, and it's all about you. And so it's so easy to say, this is what I believe, and I can discount all of this material, because after all, it's just their personal stories told across the generations, through all these different cultures, through all these different religious grids. I can just discount those things because it's not my idea or my story. That's what I think about what this gentleman has just said. I think that we do have to listen to each other, and we do have to take into account that if someone's lying, like maybe a million people are lying.
Okay. There was a gentleman over here.
I was asked.
Okay. Anything else? Yes, back there, Robert.
Yeah, what was else? This corner has a bad reverb in my ears. Bernie, me and you do audio and video for QVC TV. We have a terminology in our industry called phantom power. Do you really understand where the word phantom comes from?
Yeah, I think so. Phantom is like a ghost. Mm-hmm. The same thing, I think it's a synonym. Same idea, different word.
So we use phantom power for shielding and powering different things. So you know, we had someone talk about EMF and stuff like that. There have been causes of voices being recorded without anybody's knowledge. This is a proven fact in audio-video industry. So what's your opinion on that?
You're saying it's a proven fact that voices have been recorded with nobody making them?
Right. Hearing them physically. Like me and you are talking right now, and then when you play back the recording off the camera or off your secondary camera, there was a different sound that was not placed there where no one heard.
And it's a voice.
And it's a voice.
And it's English.
It'd be any language.
Yeah. No, I would say that's not a fact at all. It kind of reminds me of, I've seen some of those ghost shows, ghost chasers on TV, and there's a, did you hear that? It says, I'm coming for you, or something. It's like, what?
Well, some of those I disagree. I'm with you on that. I disagree with some of those.
No, I don't think there's any case at all. I would disagree there's a fact of anything being recorded that's some voice made from somewhere else recorded. I disagree that's a fact. I don't know, where was this published at? I mean, it's just hearsay?
It's been published several times in professional audio magazines.
Huh. Well, I'd be interested in seeing one article. I mean, I really doubt it. I mean, something like that would not be, something like that would be well known.
It's probably on YouTube, Bernie.
No.
Anyway, you sure?
Well, you know, let me just say something about YouTube. There's a genetic fallacy where you say something is wrong or bad based on where it came from.
Yeah, I understand it.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'm just.
Oh yeah, you can go see MIT professors on YouTube.
Okay.
Different
I just want to defend YouTube.
They're fascinating.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Actually, the evidence for extrasensory experience, ghosts, is very much alive in myself. I came here with a belief, honestly, that not believing in ghosts, but I neglect my own lived experience. Mm. I am diagnosed schizophrenic, and I do experience voices. So the whole idea of being able to record those voices and studying them in the academic field maybe is not so possible, and so it gives the delusion that, you know, the ghosts don't exist. But I can attest, I experience real characters in my life that don't exist to anyone else but myself. And that's just the truth.
Nathan, Bernie, you want to respond to that?
Yeah, one thing I would say is, have you seen that movie, A Beautiful Mind? Have you seen that?
Yeah.
You know, so basically he has an advanced stage too where he sees people and he even thinks he's participating in events that aren't real. And I thought there was a really interesting line in there where he says, when I meet somebody for the first time, I always shake their hand, and that way I know if they're real or not. That's how I know. You know, otherwise there's no way I can know if I'm really talking to a person there or not. And so basically what he's saying is, yeah, your brain is, you know, it can be malfunctioning and it's not reality. And so that's his test. What is reality? You know, he thought he was actually a code breaker when he wasn't being a code breaker and everything. So, yeah, I mean, I'm not a neurologist and don't know all the details, but I just thought that was an interesting fact to share with you about he had a test to find out what was real or not because he couldn't trust what was going on in his own brain.
Nathan?
Well, I want to say that I believe that the voices you hear are real. Whether or not your brain has produced them doesn't matter. The source of it doesn't matter. You're hearing them through all of your sensory equipment working correctly. And what you're hearing is real. And what you're hearing is immaterial. And that's part of the world that I live in. And that I believe exists.
I just had a follow-up on Robert's comment. It's what's called white noise. Yeah. And these are recorded events of sound coming through, or sometimes ghosts in the static. And when I say ghosts, I mean just odd images in recorded visual static. But it's pattern recognition. It's interesting. The trend, if you watch one of those white noise videos without subtitles, and then watch it with the subtitles next, you'll hear the words people thought they heard much more clearly when you've read the subtitles than before. So,
I do that those hidden camera things. I can do that
too. So the naturalist explanation is it's pattern recognition.
Yeah.
But if something did come through that was unmistakably clear, that would be extraordinary.
Okay.
Yeah, I just want a little quick comment. That's a big thing in the atheist secular movement here locally. It's Michael Shermer wrote about this a lot. He says we're pattern-seeking animals. We'll seek patterns even where there are no patterns. You know, like, looks like there's a face on the moon. Well, obviously, aliens must have made that. It's obviously a face. How could that be carved so well? And if you look at it from a different angle, it doesn't look like a face at all. But, you know, we're that's the way our brains work, and sometimes it fools us.
Gavin.
Hi, I just have some brief comments. Nathan, when you asked Bernie about how can you know if his wife loves him because it's not material, well, science doesn't always, not all branches of science deal with hard material things. There's also the social sciences, the soft sciences, the science of sociology, which includes talking about human relationships and belief systems. There's also the science, the social science of economics, which includes evaluating the value of stocks. So those things are also can be.
That's right. Gavin, science means the study of, right? So theology is also a science.
I would call it
every
a
field
science,
is a science.
No subject.
Well, it doesn't matter what you're going to call it because you're not a scientist. And you're not working in the academic system saying, this is the nomenclature.
Are you a scientist, sir?
No, but I'm telling you this. Because, Gavin, this is it. There's an academic system that uses your nomenclature, and you're not using it correctly. Everything that is taught at the university is either a science or it is what? What are the two big schools of the university? Every university is broken down into two big schools. Yeah, liberal arts or humanities and the sciences. This is how you use the term science. Don't play fast and loose with it. Of course, there are other sciences other than natural science. You're trying to find a way into the argument to support your atheism when I agree with you that there's many, many different sciences and we should listen to all of them.
I said that theology is a science, but to me it's a failed science. They haven't found God.
Well, there you go again with your opinions, but we're talking about nomenclature, not your opinions. We're not talking about your opinions.
Okay, well, you're saying I should use an authority. There's lots of scientists who say theology is but science.
Okay.
Richard Dawkins, I'm sure, says that.
Do you believe in ghosts?
No.
Okay.
I don't believe in
well, that's the topic of the evening.
Yeah. I was addressing your comment to Bernie about whether or not science can test things that are not hard.
So which science would you recommend to Bernie that he use? Which field of science would you recommend that he uses to discover whether or not his wife loves him?
There was a professor at PSU who's an atheist professor of philosophy. And he talked about science experiments involving animals. He says they're not something they want to test on humans. They're testing whether or not physical substances, hormones in the animal's brain, could induce the animal to behave as if it was in love with another animal. They found certain hormones would cause the animal to instantly act like it fell in love with the first animal of the same species itself, and another hormone that was the antidote, the feeling of a love, the manifestation of it, disappeared.
And would that be the field of natural science? What you're talking about right now, would that be the field of natural science?
Hormones are part of nature.
Would that be natural science or would that be sociology?
I'm not going to classify it that way because sometimes you need to integrate more.
Sounds to me like you're just making a proof for measuring love of Bernie's wife for natural science.
About my answer, sir.
Sometimes
you have to...
Gavin, I've known you for some years, and I'm cutting to the short. No, I've known you for long enough, and I've been your friend long enough to interrupt you right now and say, you just said there's more sciences than natural science, and then you give a report of a measurement of love between animals from natural science. I'm telling you, I don't want to talk in circles anymore. I want no...
Physics, there is chemistry, there is sociology, some problems you have to use multiple fields of
knowledge. Gavin, I don't want to be sucked down into your delirium. I want to have a real conversation with you.
Okay, you and Gavin can discuss this afterwards, okay?
No, I'm not going to, Gavin, because I've been here at midnight after these forums, talking with you, actually listening to you over and over and over again. I won't get sucked down into your delirium anymore. I want to be your friend, but I don't want to accept your delirium.
Why do you refer to delirium? Are you using a logical fallacy, trying to say...
Okay, Gavin, I'll talk to you afterward.
Okay, is there another question? It's Karen, is that right? Actually, no, the lady here that hasn't asked a question yet. Yes, please.
Before you go, can I just make one statement, too? One of the things that Gavin and Pastor Nathan were talking about and Karen started with, too, it looks like there could be this discussion about science, okay? And one thing I want to do is broaden that a little bit, and it's not just science, it's what more broader is called scientific thinking. And scientific thinking is more than just science, it means also using logic and, you know, looking for evidence and stuff. So scientific thinking doesn't mean everything has to be done in a lab and need blood samples. It's just, you could be doing measurements, doing blind studies, or, you know, double-blind studies and placebos, all kinds of things. But it's just scientific thinking. It's not supernatural or superstitious thinking. So I just want to broaden that out to scientific thinking, not just science.
Okay, your question, please, ma'am.
This is for Nathan. Do you have any comments about the Matthew 27 passage in the saints? Appearing to the people, the Matthew 27 passage,
where the resurrected bodies
right.
come at the right after the crucifixion.
Correct.
The promise is that Jesus' resurrection is going to be just the first of a mass scale resurrection. Of God's children. And so when Jesus dies and completes everything that the Father in heaven has required for his justice to be met, there is at that moment this bursting forth. Those bodies are not supposed to burst forth until the last day. But because the power of God in that moment is of such magnitude, it's a foretaste of what will happen on the last day. That's how I see that text.
Thank you.
Okay, other questions? Yes, Karen.
Do you believe, Nathan, do you believe in leprechauns? And if no, why not?
Well, I mean, you're not going to get many people in my position to admit that they do. But I will tell you this, I do not disbelieve in them. And the reason why I don't disbelieve in them is because there is so much... I think every myth that has been created in this world has a certain amount of truth in it. It's just not human imagination. Well, it is, but your imagination and my imagination is always rooted in some kind of experience, some kind of a vision, some kind of a view. So I don't disbelieve. I've never seen a leprechaun, and that's because I think I drive too fast.
Okay, did you run them all over?
Yeah.
Next question, how about Darth Vader? Is it possible that he exists?
Well, certainly the spirit of Darth Vader exists. We all know a Darth Vader. Some of us have had dads that are as bad as Darth Vader.
The Jedi's on the dark side, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, another question.
Let's force somebody to have a question.
Want to draft somebody?
I'm over my quota.
You're over your... Well, you know, the quota was one each to give everyone a chance. So if there's no other takers, Karen, you're welcome to have your third.
Well, Nathan, is there anything... if there's something that happens, and do you ever say, I don't believe, how do you come to disbelief?
Well, first of all, disbelief is a very sad thing.
In anything. Somebody says a story, blah, 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 and you say, I don't believe it. What causes you to come to a conclusion?
Most of my comments tonight about that is what I should say publicly or to another person, as opposed to what I truly believe. Now, I've been pretty cheeky tonight. Like, I've never shut Gavin down before in 4 years. But I did tonight, because he got under my skin. And I just think that if we're going to be friends and good neighbors, and someone says something that's delirious, we ought to say something about it. But I just broke my rule with him, because I just told you 10 minutes before that my doctor friend told me I should just say, thank you for sharing, Gavin. That's very interesting. But that's, if we want to be good neighbors, we can't do what I just did to Gavin, because our culture's too fragile for that.
I'm not talking about a theological belief. I'm talking about something that happens in the world. That didn't happen, I don't believe it.
So what you're asking, if I can try rephrasing it, is someone tells you, Nathan, you'll never believe this, but yesterday this and this happened. Under what circumstances would you say, either to that person or to yourself, say, that's very interesting, but I don't believe it?
Well, if that person came back to me and said, you know what, Nathan, I was lying through my teeth, then I'd say, okay, good, because it didn't sound very believable to me.
Yeah, but it's more about how do you prove something? I'm sure in your life your kid comes home and says, my brother came home once and said, Mom, I didn't hit Bobby Ann over the head with a hammer. I didn't.
Right. So when my kids come home, my children know that if they come home and they report anything to me negatively about their teachers at school, that I won't believe them. They know that until I investigate it. Yeah. So investigation is a word that's quite broad. Mm-hmm. And I know that's what you're fishing for. And so, yeah, we investigate. If I care enough, if it's important enough, if my child is really disturbed and comes home and says, you know, Mrs. did this or Mr. did that, I'll investigate it. A lot of investigation, the vast majority of investigation, all has to do with personal testimony, with reports. Day in and day out, grand juries meet downtown Portland, and they take personal testimony, and they try people for heinous crimes. And there's no circumstantial evidence, because testimony trumps circumstantial evidence in the courts of investigation that we hold dear.
Yes, sir.
I need to say something about truth. My understanding is, from a philosophical point of view, a truth is a truth when enough people say it's true. It's not intrinsic to the idea or the thing.
Okay, I'll take that. We're getting right short of time, so I'll take that as a question. And the question would be, do you agree that a truth is a truth if enough people believe it? Nathan and then Bernie. I'm going to ask you to sit down. We've got just barely enough time for them to respond to that before they make their closing statements. Okay? Would you agree a truth is a truth if enough people believe it's true?
Well, it certainly sways me if a lot of people believe something. I'm not going to discount it easily, but it doesn't make it true just because more people believe this than believe this. But if a large group of people say this is true, then there's some collective holding to it, and I'm going to pause before I say you're all wrong, especially if I'm the odd man out.
Okay. Bernie?
Just to do a little bit of a redirect, I think a related thing that's more important to the point is the question of what is a fact. And Stephen Jay Gould, believe it or not, facts are kind of difficult to define. And Stephen Jay Gould is a deceased person, but he's kind of famous in some of these debates. But he basically said, defined a fact as something that is so obvious it'd be perverse to deny it, kind of thing. You know, like it's a fact, I'm here right now. You know, well, you have to be insane to deny that. That's why it's a fact. So, then as far as you have all these facts, you basically try to put them together to determine what reality is, and this is why science changes, is because they're trying to figure out what reality is, and they're getting closer and closer and closer to it. Like, Newtonian physics is closer to real life than is the, Einstein relativity is closer than Newtonian physics, basically, for example, especially approaching the speed of light at that speed. So these are more refinements. So we're getting closer and closer to that reality, but we're still not there. I mean, they have dark energy and dark matter that consist of most of the universe, and they call it dark because they don't know what it is yet. So when we discover some of these things, it may totally blow our minds as far as what's underlying all reality. But
so would you agree or disagree with the statement that if enough people believe it's so, it's probably so?
No, I mean, the number of people believing something is totally irrelevant. It's totally irrelevant to the truth.
Okay. Would you agree with what Nathan said that if enough people believe something, it would cause you to think more carefully?
Well, you know, what kind of matters who the people are. There's a thing called scientific consensus. So if like 95% or 99% of the biologists agree to something, sure, that's a very strong contender for the truth. But if you said 95% of the American population believe this, that doesn't really mean anything, as far as I'm concerned.
All right.
I agree with that.
Okay, well, we're right at the end here. And at the end, we have a chance for each of you to take make a two-minute summary of what you have to say. And have we agreed on who's going to give the summary first?
I'll go first.
Okay, go ahead, Nathan.
Well, he's going out of the room. Why don't you go first?
Yeah, okay, that's probably good, because that way you can have the final word since you're so gracious. I want to thank Pastor Nathan for doing this. It's very rare to do this in a church, and so I'm very, very thankful for Pastor Nathan for doing these communications. So basically, in summary, I like the word philosophical naturalism because it means philosophically, I think there's just nature is all there is. There's nothing supernatural. And in no way do I find that depressing. In a way, coming from a Christian background that I was a born-again evangelical Christian for a long time. And yes, it's depressing now trying to deal with my mortality because before I was in denial. Before I thought I was going to live forever. I had eternal life. But you know, now I just figure that I'm dealing with reality. And, you know, it's in the same way a child might be depressed when they find out Santa Claus is not real. You can't replace that. Well, somebody else is going to give me presents if I'm good. No, sorry, there's just no replacement for Santa Claus. This is reality we're talking about. And, you know, I'm not saying to put this down, but in my mind, you know, the God character is the same exact level as Santa Claus. They're both fictional characters in the brain. I don't see any good evidence whatsoever for the existence of God. When I was a Christian, I used to be afraid at night, to sleep in the dark. I used to have a little nightlight even, you know. And now it's kind of funny because I can challenge myself. Hey, I don't believe in demons or ghosts or anything. So it's like, hey, turn, you know, let's see what the dark is like. You know, it's kind of fun. I'm looking for a haunted house. I'd love to sleep in one. Can't find them anywhere. That's why I know. So anyway, that's just a summary that I believe everything's natural, there's nothing supernatural, and I really do not believe in the existence of God. So.
Okay. Nathan?
Well, I was waiting for Gavin to come back in the room, and I'll just have to apologize to him afterward. But I want you to know that I don't feel that I interacted with him well, and that what I said to him was very rude. And I will ask him to forgive me for that. My neighborly relationship with Gavin for years is much more important to me than the topic of ghosts, frankly. And so in the heat of the moment, talking about what is a good argument and not a good argument for ghosts or the spirit world or anything, I forgot what was really important, even though we said that's what we're doing in these forums. is trying to build neighborly relationships across opposing lines. So I hope that you can see that, and I hope that the next time I participate, I can be freer of that kind of behavior. And I want to thank you all for participating. And I do think that if there is anything immaterial that we agree is immaterial, then there might be more immaterial existence out there beyond what you and I have perhaps considered. And that's really what the topic was tonight, with Bernie's popularized question, do you believe in ghosts? Mm-hmm. So before you say, no, I don't believe in ghosts, if you believe in the human mind, or if you believe in the concept of mathematical numerals, or if you believe in a warm, fuzzy feeling, you just can't say, no, I don't believe in spirits or demons or angels or ghosts without doing a little bit more research.
Well, thank you very much for coming. Those who did not get your questions answered, if you'd like to take a chance to interact, Bernie and Nathan will be up here, and they'd be more than happy to discuss things one-on-one. And please, I think there's probably some pizza and cake left, so please don't leave without eating more.
Happy Halloween, huh?
There you go.
Thank you.